So drastic, which is the methodology that we used in order to characterize the aquifer, is really just a, I guess an acronym based on all of the different properties that go into doing this assessment. So it deals with depth to water table. Here's Alyssa. Hi. Alyssa. Oh. Hi. That doesn't sound good. Okay, try again. Sorry about this. Basically, the drastic method is a widely used methodology. The U.S. Environmental Protection Agency came up with it, and this is just what a lot of hydrogeologists use as a methodology. It does these seven physical characteristics of the land. They look at geological and soil maps. Like I said, this is a desktop study. You didn't come out here to look at it at all. Hello. That works. Okay, I'm gonna put you on speaker. Oh dear. Okay. All right, you're live.
Okay.
Welcome. You bring up with Alyssa. So again, Alyssa and her colleagues here, they looked at water well logs. They looked at the aquifer classification information that the province provides on the aquifer here. And then they put all of this information together to come up with a risk rating, basically, of all those different layers coming together. I'll go through these in a little bit more detail later, once we look at a bit more of the information. So the limits of the study, as you can see, what we talked about, just a little bit of South Slocan at the top, Crescent Valley, Shoreacres there, Boykin Subdivision. The aquifer actually goes all the way up to Ballycan, and it follows the Slocan River in a very narrow strip all along, and then it widens out once it gets to the confluence of the Slocan and Kootenay Rivers. So anything that happens up there does eventually flow into your drinking water here. The western boundary follows the Slocan River. There's a separate aquifer on the other side of the river. So if you're in, they're not connected. I don't believe, and Alyssa will call me out on that if it's not true. It's been classified by the province as glacio-fluvial sand. All that means is a glacier pushed by here and it dropped a lot of sand and gravel. So it's a really porous aquifer. You hear sometimes about there being bedrock aquifers. This one is a sand and gravel aquifer. So it's really porous, things move through it really quickly, which can affect the vulnerability of it. In terms of the way that the groundwater moves, you can imagine that the Slocan River is flowing this way from northeast, there's northwest to southeast, and the Kootenay River is flowing south at this point. That's pretty much the direction of the groundwater flow as well. So again, anything that happens up here will end up here eventually. So most of the wells in this aquifer, as you're probably aware of, use in your community is for domestic use. Residences, there's not a lot of commercial use. Most of the well records that we looked at provide some reporting that says there's a good amount of water. It's relatively good. Now, there might be little pockets that are better than others, but overall it provides good water. And that's between like 2 and 105 gallons a minute. So you can see there's quite a bit of variation depending on where you are. The depth of wells, that's also quite variable. Some wells are only 6 feet deep or 1.8 meters. Do you prefer metric or imperial?
Where's the wind?
All right, I'll do both and then we'll keep it there. So the other ones, there's other wells here that are over 534 feet deep. Or 163 meters. So like some of them are super deep to get water and some of them they're getting water right at the surface. Again, you can imagine that that makes a big difference on how vulnerable your water source becomes.
And that's in the same aquifer from 6 feet to 500 feet and that's it the same?
That's right.
Oh my gosh.
Yep.
Are the higher ones up top?
I don't know for sure, so let's, can you remember that question, and we'll get Alyssa in at the end to answer that. Basically, on average, they're on average about 130 feet deep. When we looked at 92 well logs from the provincial database, and on average, that's about where we end up. So now I'm going to get back to these drastic inputs. We looked at depth to the water table. So this varies across this. So let's look at it in terms of, you know, where you are in the world is usually your house or your yard. The depth to the water table, that is what varies quite a bit. In some areas, it's quite low. Like, obviously, if the well's only 6 feet deep, the water table is pretty high. Otherwise, it's going to be down a little bit further in order to access it. The depth to water table also changes depending on if there's been gravel extracted. In some areas of the aquifer, there's been gravel pits. So you take that top layer off, all of a sudden the depth to the water table drops to here. The recharge, that is based on precipitation. So recharge in groundwater, it rains on top, it percolates down through the sand and gravel, and then it gives you more fresh water within your aquifer. So they're always linked, but there is a filtration that goes through as well.
Isn't the slow can fill it?
Pardon me?
Doesn't the slow can river fill the aquifer?
That's again another question for Alyssa. Hey Alyssa, are you hearing these?
I can hear some of it.
So the question was, does the Slocan River recharge the aquifer?
And the Kootenay River.
And the Kootenay River.
Yes, it will both be connected to the upper parts of the aquifer.
Okay, we might as well do your question now before I forget.
Okay,
anytime. The aquifer media, that's what kind of material is present at a depth, and that's from where the water well pumps right here. So it's about where you're going to have a well that goes into where the water is, and it trying to figure out what the aquifer media is. In this case, in the majority of your wells, it's sand and gravel. The more coarse the material is, the more vulnerable it becomes. The finer material, like if you're getting down to a clay layer, that tends to become a bit of a barrier to contaminants getting into it. So the more coarse it is, the more vulnerable you'll look at it. There's also the soil media. That's the top 2 to 3 meters here. And so the type of soil media always also affects how vulnerable your aquifer is going to be. Fine soils like clay, as I said, like they don't let as many contaminants through. Coarser materials like sands and gravels, they let a lot more through. The topsoil in this area is mostly sandy loam, more loamy sand near Shoreacres. And loam is something that you guys are all familiar with different types of soils, and loam is better to farm with. The silty loam is in the northeast near the Slocan River, and we specifically then addressed areas where this topsoil layer had been removed, like in the aggregate operations. So if you look at, I'll probably get into it, hold on. We identified them in black squares because it's a unique area. The topography, this also affects how quickly contaminants will rush down. If you're on a steep terrain, you can imagine they're going to go by quickly. They're not going to have a lot of chance to drop down. On flatter terrain, or if you're in a bowl, they're going to get trapped there, and they're going to have a lot longer to sit down in that kind of terrain. So topography comes into it as well. The impact of the vadose zone. Now that's something I even had to look up. Basically, the vadose zone is this dry layer between where the water table is and where the soil media is. And that can create a confining layer. Again, like I said, if that is made of, if that vadose zone is clay, it can block contaminants moving into the water table. If it's sand and gravel, it's kind of porous and it comes right through. And then the hydraulic conductivity, that's the ability of the aquifer to transmit water. And so when you drill a new well, the pump driller or the driller will do a pump test, and they'll figure out how much water your well is going to be able to produce. So that is directly related to the hydraulic conductivity. If it's got really good conductivity, you're going to get a lot of water out of that pump test. If it's really hard to kind of squeeze it through all the cracks, you're going to get a low result in your pump test. basically, what the hydrogeologist did was take all of those rankings, analyze the data, weighed them out in terms of importance based on this formula, and then they came up with every 50 by 50 square, this is going to be easier to see here, every 50 by 50 square got a vulnerability rating. So you can see on the left-hand side here, the depth, the recharge, you've got the soil conductivity, you've got the topography, that vagus zone, and the conductivity of the aquifer flowing through, all those things sandwiched together to get this lovely map. And like, as I mentioned, the areas in black are areas that we saw on air photos and just local knowledge of where these operations are. Those are areas where the topsoil has been removed. The other areas here, basically your entire aquifer is moderately vulnerable. You've got something that you should think about in terms of quantifying where the contaminants would be. The red zones, which is primarily in Shoreacres, those are areas of high vulnerability. And that's because of like all of those different factors coming into it. It was basically the groundwater here is more shallow, there's low land slope, and there's a lack of fine-grained geological layers to protect the top.
So the red areas could be trouble?
So if you have contaminants, and I'll get into this look at that, it's right here. all we've done now is identify what the pathways are. Those red areas, that says basically there's a really easy pathway for contaminants to get into your drinking water. But that's only a pathway. If you don't have a receptor, people drinking it, so obviously we have people drinking it, so we have a pathway and we have a receptor. But what we don't know are the threats, because you don't actually have a risk if you don't have anything that's going to contaminate your drinking water, right? You have to have a pathway, which you have to be drinking the water, and be vulnerable to those things. Some of you will have been drinking this water your entire life, and you could be drinking water with E. coli in it, and because your system is immune to it, you'll never get sick. But usually people with immunocompromised systems, typically younger, like babies and elderly people, they have more issues with immunocompromised systems. So that's where you're going to notice any bacteriological contamination that comes into it. So the threat, we haven't gone into the threats yet. All we were looking at in terms of this study was the pathways. And what we want to talk about are, because you know the community way better than we do, what do you think the threats are? You know, and so we'll talk a little bit about them, just to introduce it. We haven't yet mapped them. We haven't really looked at them. We kind of know what general threats are to drinking water. Septic fields. Poorly maintained septic fields or old septic fields, especially when you have shallow intake and your septic field is not very far from your wellhead or, you know, your neighbors, and you have a lot of wellheads, you know, in a concentrated area. That can be a big threat. However, you know, we don't know how many people have gotten sick. We don't know what the interior health reports are. We don't know necessarily where all your septic tanks are and your septic fields are, because we haven't gone into that level. Basically, if we were to get into that level of assessment, we have to go through interior health. We've got to, you know, pay $500 a shot to get the records. Most of the places have been built long, long ago. The records won't exist. And so we really wanted to figure out where the risks and talk to the community, find out where what the actual risks are, and then move forward on a more cost-effective basis. The other threat considerations that we talk about are fuel storage within your properties, the use of fertilizers or pesticides, and the storage of those. Now that can be in more, like, not necessarily residential use, but farming use, absolutely. That kind of level. Road salts as well. And commercial and industrial activities. And again, you know, talking about what the industrial and commercial activities are. It's a bit of an information gathering session, so we'd like to find out from you guys, you know, again, what are the fears, what are the known issues, and then look into that further. So looking at examples of groundwater risk, I talked a little bit about it. The top one, the top left there, that basically shows a septic field, and I don't know how many people's septic fields look pink, but in this case it works. So basically you'll see the septic field going into a shallow well, which then goes down to the bottom of the well and you can get your neighbor's well, that type of thing, and get into the aquifer supply. We talk about construction activity. If you're building quite a bit down, you know, you're doing an excavation for a basement, you're digging 10 feet down, and you know that you're, you know, the water table is up at about 6 feet, you can be getting closer to that water table. We look at pits and quarries up at the top end. You can see they, you know, if you remove enough of that that fine grain layer at the top, that can get you closer to the water table. It's basically anything that gets you closer to the water table that could provide a preferred pathway for contaminants to get in there, that increases your vulnerability. And then buried infrastructure and abandoned wells. If you have old wells on your property and you don't decommission them, it's basically a straw that goes right down into that aquifer. So there's, you know, there's legislated methodologies on how you should just cap, you know, fill it with bentonite, clay, cap your old wells, and then you reduce the number of straws that go in. So this is where we can open it back up to the discussion, and perhaps Mary can lead this part. But basically what we were talking about is the opportunity to ask some questions of myself and of Alyssa, or of the regional district, and then also have an opportunity to provide your comments. And if anything hasn't been clear, please feel free to ask, and Alyssa will be smarter than I am.
So some of these questions we have on the tables as well, if people want to think about them. I don't want to delve too much into the land use activity because that's something we can discuss as a community at later sessions, and it's more complex. But certainly when we have our consultants here, this is a great opportunity to ask some of those technical questions you might have. Certainly from a regional district perspective, we can try to respond to any concerns or any opportunities you see. We have heard some concerns expressed already by residents in terms of how does this impact property values? How does this impact how I can use my property? So some of the information we brought with us today as well. So just kind of elaborating on the issue with threats. We did get copies of septic records for the plan area or study area from Interior Health through a Freedom of Information request. We got 32 records. There's certainly more than 32 properties in the study area. So it's a very incomplete record, and that's part of the issue of why we can't go further with this information. There's no way to get the data, right? A lot of the septic systems were installed prior to there maybe being record keeping, but it's a very incomplete picture, and it wouldn't really give us an accurate analysis of data. That said, I do have some handouts here, because I think one of the scariest things when you get a study like this as a resident is we jump to the worst case scenarios right away. It's just human nature, right? It's, oh my gosh, I'm in the red or I'm in the yellow, and I'm gonna go get my drinking water tested right away. Certainly, if that's how you feel, I would encourage you to. We do have information for water testing here. We also have information on how to maintain wells to increase their resilience. And registered on-site waste practitioners. So 25, 30 years is certainly empower yourselves to do that as individuals if you want to look at, you know, how this impacts your own individual properties. But certainly, as Elise pointed out, is all we know right now is that there's vulnerabilities. We don't know with any level of certainty what the threats are. And those are very difficult to determine in a rural area because of the lack of information and records to make a conclusion like that. So certainly we know that septic systems contribute to the problem. We know the gravel or aggregate operations may contribute by taking that upper layer off. We also know there's all sorts of land use activities that may or may not have occurred in the community over time that increase that level of risk. So what I'm going to let us go into is Elise has put up some kind of leading terms up there. And we'll open it up to any questions because we do have Alyssa, who's the hydrogeologist, on the line as well to respond to any questions.
Yes. I just was curious to know, is the quantity of the aquifer, is it a good size aquifer? There's lots of available water?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Overall, it has been identified as a good producing aquifer.
Okay.
Question. How many homes is there right now in Shoreacres?
We looked at 92 well lots.
92?
Yes. So
in
not in Shoreacres proper.
83 study from Dayton and Knight come out in May of 1984.
Yes.
For the regional district. And I think at that time there was 128 residences in Shoreacres here.
Okay.
And there's meetings, there's concern because the zoning was going in, and what the concern was that the groundwater is going to get polluted if you go to more density. And there was meetings in Shoreacres here. And it settled on to keep it to 1 acre, I believe, at that time.
One hectare.
Yeah, if it went to small, some people wanted a half acre lots and stuff like that. But there is a concern about the groundwater will get polluted. So, mind you, that is 1984, that's a while back. Floyd Dykeman was there on the regional director, and Barry Baldegara was the secretary, and Henderson was. And I was on the committee to represent Shoreacres or a couple of other fellows, but they're no longer here.
Yes.
So it was decided at that time that to keep it at 1 hectare because the concern was the aquifer. So this is the thing is, I thought maybe there's more than 128, and it was discussed, you know, the maximum of 240, but then it would entail putting in a water system, Rover Creek, that was iffy, but well, in the north end of Shoreacres, the one by the beach.
Yeah, so that study and 1984 looked at three different scenarios for water.
Yeah, four different scenarios. There's Wharton subdivision, Claymore subdivision, Webb subdivision,
and
Rover Creek, and then the groundwater. And anyway, I was just interested to know if, you know,
We were not updating, we read the Dayton and Knight report from 1984.
I have that, I have the report.
Yeah, and Alyssa and her team reviewed it as well as part of this assessment.
Yes.
But it wasn't the same scope. We weren't looking at the same thing. We're not looking to get you a new water system here at this time. The scope of this assessment was to basically look at the areas within your aquifer that were vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
So that, they are linked, I totally get you there, but that wasn't the scope of this assessment. So what I hear from you is that this is a fear that's been happening in the community for a long time, is density and septic systems. Because the reason why you would contaminate your aquifer in an increasing way with increased density is because you don't have sewage collection here. So in order to get increased density, you need your sewage to go somewhere. So then you would be increasing how many septic fields you have in the community. So did I get your concerns?
Well, I was just, you know, back in 1984, the cost wasn't bad, but now the cost probably should be possible to put a water system in because the cost of the exorbitant, you know.
It can be quite expensive.
Yeah.
To do treatment. Like there are opportunities though, and one of the opportunities for granting, if you like, you know, as part of an RDCK water system, and that's a whole other kettle of fish, but that you have the opportunity to get grants, and the province does like to provide people with potable water if
unfortunately they at that time, shortly after that, the study went through. Where the government would give a grant of 75% and they lowered it 25%, so.
Well, that's no longer.
That's a lot of money.
You're lucky to get, like, you know, you put in one third, they'll pay two thirds.
Yeah, so it's.
Yeah.
Okay, that's.
So you've been in this for a while?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm quite aware of the water.
Yes, at the back.
So we had a study in the 80s that said our water's at risk. Now we got another study saying our water's at risk. What's RDCK's plan to address this? Like, is there any changes to land use bylaws or any developing considerations? Like, what is RDCK planning to do?
Yeah, so part of the reason this project was initiated is because we are undertaking your community plan review currently.
Okay.
And so the intent was, this was intended to inform decision making on what land use will look like. One of the maps that we do have available over there is an analysis of further development potential within the study area. So as was spoken to, you know, when zoning was brought into Shoreacres, the minimum lot size was kept at a 2.47 acre or 1 hectare minimum parcel size. That's still in place. However, in Area I, there was a provision to allow for the placement of a modular for immediate family. And so over time, even though there's those density provisions, is there has been incremental increases in density because of that provision.
Yeah.
So part of the conversation that we have to have with you as a community is, do those provisions still work? Maybe they work in a different way. There's lots of different ways of addressing density and land development that doesn't increase risk to water supply, right? So when we look at the regulations as they were put in place in the 1980s and 1990s, there's really only four properties in the study area, with the exception of Area H that doesn't have regulation, that can be further developed. Right, it is right now, even with your current regulations, there's very little, there's very few properties within Shoreacres that have the potential for additional dwellings,
yes.
Subdivision, things like
that. What about industrial though? Because, I mean, Klesnikov put in a building that